I will continue with my presentation. It's all about the 3DN integration framework, and it will mainly focus this presentation on the 3DN sites. My name is Ivo van der Lagemaat. Probably you recognize my accent that I come from the Netherlands. I'm a product owner for 3DN. I started my career at 3DN in 2001. I worked on the content manager bit for about 10 years. Then I did a couple of years for media manager. And lately I'm a product owner for 3DN, the 3DN product. First focusing on sites and currently also moving to docs as well. So the whole portfolio from the 3DN suite. The agenda, I'll talk about the integrations, how we actually see it and why we need it. Talk about the framework in general, not to a specific implementation, but how the framework is working. And once you have the framework, you can also have connectors using that particular framework, and also how we deploying the connectors in 3DN in general. Okay, the integrations. In the marketing landscape, it's pretty large. It's about 7,000, more than 7,000 vendors there, and each has their own bit or part in that landscape. And in 3DN, we can't fulfill the whole landscape. We will, like a small company, compared to the number of vendors, and there's like e-commerce for them, and it's for us almost impossible to have an answer for all those spaces, basically. And maybe companies already have bought a product for an e-commerce or a dense system. So it's better approach to have a better breed scenario that you actually make it possible to connect to such vendors and actually consume that particular product in our whole 3DN product and use it on the websites as well. For that way, it is, yeah, I think it works both ways. You don't have to come up with an answer for every column on the data or e-commerce or social in our portfolio, but we can actually use existing software as well. So then we come up with a 3DN integration framework. Before, we had a little bit a notion about integration as well on the 3DN sites. It was the external content library, and you can actually use what it actually says, content from external library. But that was only focusing more on the content management side, not on the content delivery side. So you have to probably download or consume all the content already in the content manager side, and then republish that bit to the content delivery, and then you can actually put it on your website and consume it over there. So now we actually want to have a 3DN integration framework that works across 3DN, the content manager side, and also the content delivery side. And with that framework, you can actually build connectors to like OpenText, to Marketo, to Primo, Oracle. It doesn't really matter anymore. You still want to write one connector, and you can actually use it then on the content manager side, but also on the content delivery side. And then on the content manager side, you basically create a link to the item you want to use from a third-party vendor, like for OpenText or Marketo. And then you only need to maintain that link during your transition from the content manager bit to content delivery. And once you know it on the content delivery, you can actually use that same connector to pull that content from that other vendor. So for example, if you have like a PIM system, you make your reference on content management site, you actually publish it on your web page, you only have the link to the content or to the PIM system. And from that one, because you have that reference, you can use the same connector, go to the PIM system, and extract the right data from it. So you can actually have an up-to-date price or the up-to-date image published on your website. You don't have to maintain it or publish it again to have the latest version. So in that way, I think it's a better approach of having connectors working for content manager and content delivery. Bit about the whole framework in general. It's not specific to content manager or content delivery, but just a notion how this framework works. So imagine you have a machine, it can be also a virtual machine. And on that machine, you have an application running. And that application can be written in Java or .NET. It doesn't really matter anymore for us. Then you have actually in that application, you're consuming this framework basically, and it consists basically of a connector manager. And that that connection manager is just a library you can hook into your current application. And connector manager is written both in .NET but also in Java. So in that way, it doesn't really matter what your application is written in, .NET or Java, you can actually use the same connector manager. And in this connector manager, we're using actually gRPC, that is actually stands for Google Remote Procedure Calls. It's not invented by us, but we actually consume it or use it, what Google produced. And this actually gives the possibility to create a remote process and communicate with it on the machine itself. It can also be in other machines as well, but for us, we do it locally on the same machine. And then, of course, you can have a .NET core client and also talk to the gRPC, to that particular client. And in that client is the connector. So it's really separated from your main application. And of course, there's also an option to have another connector loaded, and that can be a Java client. So your application can be either also in .NET or Java, and your connector can also be written in .NET or Java. You can have a mix match. It doesn't really matter for us. Thanks to the gRPC, it's a separate process. We can easily make use of it, and we're more language independent anymore. Once you have your application, you might need to specify some kind of contract, because what do you want to retrieve from the remote system? How are you handling the remote system? So you, part of the framework, you have to give it a contract. And a contract you basically implement on your application, but also on the connector. So from the application point of view, you're using the contract, but with some magic, you get that same contract is there on the client, and that way it is separated, but still feels connected. We're talking about the same contract. So if you implement it on the client in the application, it feels like they're really connected. You won't notice the difference from the application point of view. If you've seen in the previous slide as well, you have the .NET core client and the Java client. And basically, we call them launchers. They're basically launching a new process. And that process, like I said, it can be Java or .NET Core. It also gives us a process isolation. If your application is running and you're developing your connectors and they're not that stable yet, they don't crash your main application. It will crash that particular process of that connector. And we can detect it as well. With the connector manager, it will keep some kind of pinging there. If it loses connection, it will try to kill it and launch you a new one. So from the application point of view, it doesn't even notice it. It is crashing, but it will be a little bit slower, but we try to launch a new one and set up the communication. But in general, it is more resilient as well for this one. So it doesn't crash your whole main application. Then we have also as well logging. If you write a connector, you have to think about also logging. And in that logging, you don't want to know anything about if I'm running on a Java world or a .NET world, is it running on Windows, really on Linux? For example, if you write it in a .NET one, you go to your C drive and then store your data there or your log file there. There's no C drive on a Linux machine, for example. So in that way, if you build a connector, we also pass you a logging framework to it, so a logging object. You can make use of that one. And then if you try to log something from your connector, it will go to the application, and the application can use its own logging mechanism how to log stuff. So if, for example, you run it in Content Manager, you have the event system, then you can log it in the event system. If you run it on Linux on the UDP side, you have maybe another way of logging stuff, but you can also log a log stash or whatever of the main application it is using. So it's basically, you don't have to care about the logging. If you use the logging we supply, then it's okay. You don't have to care about if you're running it on Windows or Linux or whatever. So we have the framework in place, but still we want to isolate a little bit where we're going to use it. And the first focus on using this integration framework is on the external content library. So the external content library is there for years now. It is something called like ECL providers. They keep on working. We didn't change anything about it. So if it's currently ECL providers, they keep on working. But now you get also connectors to it. So the external content library works with both of them. So the main use case is actually consume external multimedia assets. It's also for messing up content with external data and treating content. The same with how it was before with with ECL. And it's also easy to use for editors. We didn't change the interface actually for ECL. It's still functioning. You don't know the difference basically. When using the external content library, it basically more or less feels the same as it was before. But with the new connectors, you can also now use them as well on the content delivery side. And the content delivery side as an endpoint for GraphQL. And that GraphQL is extensible. And we make use of this extensibility mechanism. And that extensibility is basically using the existing extension points on that one. So you can query for particular data using this external data on the GraphQL point. And I will show that later in a demo. So the GraphQL is available through the 3DNDS service. Like I mentioned, it's there for since 9.0. And then indeed the external data can be accessed more or less in a managed way. You give pass the reference to your application on the delivery side. You can extract the right ID there and then go to GraphQL to get all the detailed information. Like for e-commerce, you can ask for the price or for the image or for the content itself. Well, this is indeed how it works from content manager, content delivery. We make it available to the external content library, and we also make it available in the GraphQL endpoint. Still, we haven't talked about connectors themselves. So connectors are basically defined also using a contract, like I was mentioning before. You need a contract in your application, and the contract on the connectors, they must be the same and implemented as well, both in the application and in the connector. So on the contract, what's actually in the contract? In the contract also exists of entities. Entities are more like objective properties. It can be a video with a title and a name about something like the height and the width, or a PIM system like the SKU code, or the normal title or name, or some description with an image. And there are not only entities in it. Entities are really exposed through the 3DN integration framework. And you see this actually, the entities more for the external metadata in the external content library, or like the properties you see in the GraphQL endpoint. And I will show that also later in a demo. We also have support for binaries. It's binaries, you can actually retrieve them from the system as well. During implementation, you also have to think about how I can handle binaries as well. If you're using something for a DEM system, or for example, Vimeo, do you actually want to give out the whole video itself? Maybe it's gigabytes of work, so do you actually make it possible? Yes or no? Or do you only give the reference to the binary? And also you have to think about binaries as well. If they're really like on-premise, so the public facing website doesn't have access to, do you want to give out the link to the particular image, or do you really want the context through the GraphQL endpoint? So that's something to think about doing implementations, but both scenarios are possible with the connector. We also support for schemas. If you're familiar with the external content library, there's the external metadata there, and the metadata is based on schemas. And we also have support for schemas as well. In the schema, you basically define on your entities. And on the entities, you can say like it's a, you give it a name and a value, and then it will show up in the external metadata. And also it is used as well in the GraphQL endpoint. You can also give the type, like if it's an integer, or a number, or text, or rich text. And I will also show that during the demo. The connector also supports search, so you can also search for related content in your remote system. And we have associations as well. So if you're going to select an item from your remote system and use it in Tridion, content manager side, we will notify you that it's going to be used. And that way you can also notify your system as well that it's used in Tridion. So if you want to delete something on your remote system, you can actually detect, hey, it is in use by Tridion, you can't delete it. And when it's not used anymore in Tridion, you can update it, hey, this it's unlinked. And you can also unlink it then in your own system from Tridion, and then you can actually delete it. That scenario is covered as well. Then we have some capabilities. It's more like we have functionality for getting an item. Like you select a reference, in that way you can also get it, a particular one. We have support for list and also for pagination as well. So if you have if you use for some S3 bucket with 10,000 items in one folder, you can also implement your own pagination to have like only show 25 items in your list in Tridion and navigate through the pagination through it. You can also run queries, and queries also runs the same paginated list you can use. On the graphical endpoint, there's also possibility for mutations. So for example, if you have a connector to a CRM system and people want to register, for example, you can create the form basically in Content Manager, reuse it on Content Delivery, and if people type in the details, you can use the same graphical endpoint with the connector and create the particular user then, for example, in Salesforce. You can also update or delete them as well. That was a bit about the connector and the context. And if you look at the implementation, the context are basically interfaces. But if you want to build your own connector only using interface, you have to do a lot of stuff yourself. And you basically have to repeat it every time you build a connector. So that way, for us, it makes more sense to help the community build connectors to produce an SDK that will help building those. And that SDK is both available in .NET and also in Java. So what does it do, this SDK? If you have a connector, you have to register your capabilities. So for example, if you want to retrieve an entity, you have to support a get entity implementation. But you also have to register it, so the connector manager knows about it. It probably makes sense if you have something like the update as well. You have to also give or register the capability that you support updates for your particular entity. You can know it basically on entity type, but also on the entity itself, if you want to support the update. This is particular handy if you want to go, for example, for YouTube. You have particular channels. In some channels, you can update video metadata, and some other channels, you don't. It depends on your how you actually logged in and communicate to the particular channel. So on this base, we also support all kind of scenarios. Like I said, we have support for pagination and how to return paginated list. We also have support for it in SDK to help you returning those lists. Like I said, we have also support for schemas, and the schemas are needed for displaying the external metadata in the external content library, but also for the graphical endpoint. Building schemas is difficult, can be challenging, and with the Connector SDK, we have support basically for generating those those schemas. And last but not least, there's also configuration for the connector itself. Imagine if you want to communicate to a CRM system or DEM system, most of the times you need a URL to the remote system, or you need the credentials to log in. We also make it easier for you to implement configurations. But also, you don't have to care about the configuration. We supply the configuration. So when we launch the connector, we will also give you the configuration. And why we do it, I will explain it later as well, to a demo. So you don't have to maintain your own file, and that you read the file from disk that contains the configuration. You should implement it using the SDK or the interface to make it really manageable and ready for the future. Yeah, like I said, I will show that at the demo. I was talking about the schema definition as well. So the schemas for the entities, it consists basically of a name and description. And then we also have field types. And the field types is also a description, and those descriptions are visible in the external content library, the external metadata. You can also define your type as well, like an int, float, string, binary reference, or nested schemas is supported as well. There is also an option for is required and read only. This gives the possibility, if you want to create stuff, that you can highlight it in your UI if it's required, yes or no. And then you can define it in your connector. So the implementer of that particular website or interface knows, based on the schemas, which fields are required. And you can also put constraints on it, like min, max, or allowed values. So for temperature, it should be above 0 degrees or whatever you would like, or maybe birth date, it should not be below the year 1900, for example. You can give those restrictions. But there's also support of regex as well. It's really complicated or constrained. Maybe like an email address, you can put in a regex there as well. This is an example bit for how does it look if you implement a connector. So on the left side is the C# notion of it, and on the right side the Java version on it. And you can see as well, like on the properties, you define your schema, the schema name, and also the type. And sometimes with rich text, so you know also the interpreter, hey, it supports rich text. It can use that create new rich text editor from the new UI, for example, as well. During the implementation, we also notice we are supporting external content library. And with the external content library, we are really keen of having images as well. Then it looks very nicely in list and also with thumbnails. And generating thumbnails or resizing images can be difficult. And we came up with a solution that actually the connector framework can give the connector the possibility to resize those images or create thumbnails. And the way the connector can do it is actually ask the connector framework, do we implement this interface? Yes or no? Or is it, yeah, something like get connect the capability and give it the interface, like can you create a thumbnail for me? This one is implemented basically on the external content manager, but not on the GraphQL endpoint yet. So you have to check it before using it. The GraphQL endpoint doesn't use that much resizing images, but you can do it yourself. But currently there's no possibility there. But on the content manager, it will give you a better way of implementing it. Don't have to care about resizing images. Are there actually any, just a question, any real developers in the available, like doing .NET stuff or Java stuff currently, making connectors? A couple of them. We also make it a great experience for people building connectors or making connectors. And we started for the moment for .NET, but later on Java will follow as well. What we actually try to achieve is you should be able to create a connector based on a template within a couple of minutes. You should be able to upload it and you should see it is working. And then from that point of view, we can hook it up to your remote system and start implementing it one by one for your remote system in order to get a fully functional connector. So we actually created a template for .NET. It's for .NET Core. It's available on NuGet. If you look for 3D and connect to the template, you will find it. It's easy to install. It's easy also to create a connector format. I will also demonstrate it as well. Like I said, it's from that point of view, it is you have something that you can work on from a basis. This one works. So once you have built a connector, then the question is, how do I install it? Before you have the ECL providers, if you install it, you have to go into the machine, make modifications to the external content manager configuration. You have to put the binaries in a certain location, and then it will work. This is not a nice way of doing it. And in general, like all extensions, are pretty difficult to install currently in Tridion. So we come up basically with a new kind of deployment, and this deployment is also used for those connectors. So we introduced a new service. It's called the add-on service. And with the add-on service, you can upload, like it, the word already says probably, add-ons. And what is an add-on? An add-on is actually a package that contains one or multiple extensions. An extension is basically a extension point, and an extension point can be like a connector. It can be an ECL provider. It can be like a UI extension as well. It can be for the broker as well. There is some extension there. You can actually package it, upload it, and it will be used. This way, it is also centralized as well, and it will be picked up by the applications. So if you, for example, have a UI extension, then all in the machine where the UI is running on sees as a connection to the add-on service, it will download it and install it for you. So if in scale-out scenarios you have 10 UI machines running, all 10 of them have the same version of this particular extension. So you don't forget one, we maintain it. You don't have to log into the box anymore to install it. So in that way, it should be a better experience for the end user for maintaining and updating extensions with the add-on service. The add-ons basically are loaded when they're used on the content manager side, and on the content delivery side, they are only loaded during the launch of a service, during a startup of the service. So, like I said, this is the deployment. There are add-ons in zip packets, also the manifest file, they're describing what is in there, because we need to know what kind of extension is it. Is it for the UI of content delivery? It also has its own configuration as well. Like I mentioned, you can configure the connector and we give it the configuration to you. And how we do it is doing this deployment model. So you upload the add-on, and during the add-on, it will detect from the manifest file it requires configuration. And then you basically have to upload the configuration on this particular add-on. And then from that point of view, the add-on gets installed. And also, when launched with a particular connector, it will push the configuration to you. There are a couple of supported extension points. Like before, probably we had more extension points, but this is the list we support for the add-on service with their extensions. This list is also available since 9.1. You can find it also on docs.stl.com. And then if you go to the Tridion Science 9.1, you can find it in the documentation which extension points are there. I was talking about the manifest file. So basically, the add-on is a zip file. It consists of the manifest file, but also on the file themselves needed for the particular extension. So the UI extension maybe needs some JavaScripts, the connector needs some assemblies there. And in that manifest file, you can actually specify that configurations are required. And this is the way how you say that it is required. In your manifest file, you have to say it as well there. And then if you're building a connector, you have to give the type connector, give the nice name and some properties. And in the based on the type, we know it is connector. You have to, each kind of extension has their own particular type. So we know where to install this particular add-on or the extension in add-on. And because this is type connected, you have properties and we have the library. So that's where we reference the assembly. And we specify also the runtime. So if you build a connector, you have to specify in this manifest file the runtime. So we know which launcher to use. Is it a .NET one or a Java one? This is based on this particular properties in this manifest file. And of course, we have the same for Java. And for Java, you say the runtime is Java, and then you can give it the right class name. And there is the implementation of the connector. So the connector will launch that one and then use this particular class name to start the connector. This was all developed by R&D, and R&D doesn't ship any connectors out of the box. But we have a connectors team in Istio, and that worked really hard on it already. And they released already the Salesforce CRM connector, the SAP Commerce Cloud, previously known as Hybris. They are there to be ready to be consumed or installed. They're not free. You have to have a subscription to it. Just contact your Istio representative to get the details how to use it. And the Aprimo will be available soon. It is there. It also needs some final testing. And then it will be available. And I will try to give a small demo. It's a bit smaller than I expected, but maybe if I close it and open it again. So I prepared it a little bit, because if I do everything from scratch, it just probably takes too long. So in this way, on the add-on surface, I uploaded already two add-ons. This first one is the connector framework extension. I was mentioning before that using GraphQL, the GraphQL has some extension points. And basically the connector framework uses that particular extension point by implementing it. And what this allows us to do is loading connectors. So the GraphQL loads this particular extension port, the connector framework extension, and that one loads the connectors basically. So it's basically a two-step scenario for loading the connectors. If you come to the conclusion, hey, I installed everything, but my connectors are not loaded on the container delivery side, this might be the cause. We also experienced the same issue while testing. Sometimes we loaded, sometimes not. And then, most of the times we didn't first load the connector framework extension. And then we also have, for example, I've implemented a Vimeo connector. It was also previously built in the old ECL providers as well, but this is actually the new implementation of it. The reason why we use normally Vimeo doesn't require any authentication, and it has an open API, so it's very good for demo purposes. So I want to show you how this all can be used. So for example, I have created a nice homepage on the staging website. It's not using the solar panels, pre-sales content yet, but. And this one is just the normal one you see from the example DXA site, and nothing special there. What I want to show basically is I installed my Vimeo one, and in the Vimeo I can actually make a selection. So I have some content, models content there. I can maybe can create a new component. I created some widgets, because if you wanna create the connectors, you only have connectors, but you need sometimes some glue in between to make it available on your website, on the DXA. So I also created some widget and a DXA module to get the right experience in the end. So I give it a name. I created my Vimeo widget. And this one is basically selecting the, I call the Vimeo implementation. And this one I can have select one. So I create basically my new, oh, probably here. Did demo it before. So here's my new one, Connect 2019 new. And then I have my homepage. I did some small preparations. I'm gonna edit this one. It also has support for the new regions. And I also added a region there for my Vimeo. So in here, I can actually select my just created component, this one. It has already found a template to it. Hopefully it will edit to it. I probably pressed the wrong button. Add, now you see it is added to the Vimeo section. I will save it and then I will publish it. So the only thing basically I did is make a selection. I make a reference and there were no details there about the time length or the real title. And if publishing is successful, it should be just the success. It should be available on my homepage. Hopefully this works. When, yeah. Here you can see now the video is there. It also, I put the number of seconds there behind the title. I didn't say select it. You never have seen it, but suddenly it is there. And also the number of likes. It is there somehow. I only make the reference. So you can actually see this kind of content in the component itself. So if you open this one, wrong one. You have to go to your Vimeo. It is this particular video. I edited it. And here you have external metadata. And this is coming from the connector. Here you can see the duration in seconds, also there's some statistics, and also all the tags as well. I didn't show the tags, but they are available. This is coming from the connector. But then sometimes people are asking, yeah, I don't believe you. How can you get that content then from this on the delivery side? So this is the GraphQL endpoint on content delivery. And you can actually ask now for the what kind of connectors do I have installed? And we actually call them external namespaces. And you can select for them. And then with the GraphQL, you can specify the properties you will need. And if you want to know more about all the GraphQL endpoint, Ben is giving a presentation end of the day that will give some more details about this this endpoint. But I will so I will select it basically. And here you can see I only installed the Vimeo one. But if you have multiple installed, you can see all the namespaces and all the connectors available. Maybe I should make it a little bit. Bigger. So here actually can specify the, but still, how do we get the video? So we have external item. And that one you can specify an ECL URI. And you saw me before this one copying yourself. This was actually the URI. that is basically the reference in there that we send over. And in here you can, is actually a female user. So I'm actually going to the external system. I ask for this particular URI, and then it gives some data back. And the data you can actually cast to a particular type. And we call this basically the female video. This is the type. And if you have this as a particular type, you can see all this kind of properties of the particular type that is implemented in the connector. So this is somehow now available in the on the graphical point. So I was actually I can actually show the name of the property. What was it? I can also have the statistics. So on file name, for example. Statistics is like a property in a property. So you have nested schema support I was talking about. This is one of the cases of a nested schema. And in this one you can have the number of comments of the number of likes. If I select this one, and here you can actually see, oh, there is no file name. Maybe I should use another property. Maybe something called title. Yes. You can see this is the title of the NCC I selected, and also the number of likes. I was also mentioning the duration of the video. Here you can see 172, and it's actually the same that you saw here. So that point, or here you can actually see that we are consuming the GraphQL endpoint, retrieving that information through GraphQL, through the connector, from Vimeo. But yeah, indeed so, but still, I want to be able to create a connector very fast, like I said, from the starting point of view. We want to make it really easy for you how to create a new connector. I should basically maybe increase my font size a little bit. Oh, probably selected the wrong one. I thought it was. Yeah. So you have something like dot and new minus L, then you can actually see a list of all the templates installed. There is nothing there yet for the connectors. So you have dot net new minus I 3D dot connector. Template, and this will actually download it from NuGet and install it on your local machine. So again, if you now do dot, you already see probably in the list, but if you now also do it with the list, then you can see already here selected is the Tridion connector template. So if I now do .net new, and I mentioned Tridion connector, and give it a name. It will create a new connector. It based on the template, it will create a new connector. And the template basically outputs a project file, some entities, a full project for .NET. And then if you go to this particular folder, you can actually say .NET build. And it start building it for you. So it will start building it, but also for you creating the package that is ready to be uploaded to the add-on service. So otherwise you have to do it yourself, basically the whole packaging, but it's part of this project. So if you build it, it also has output for this particular package. So this is the correct date. And here you can see add-on package. And then you see the zip file and also the JSON. In this particular JSON is the configuration.
So if I go to my add-on,
whoa,
a huge button. I can now go to my demo for today. This is the zip file. I will upload it. It says, hey, package uploaded. Like we were also mentioning during the couple of hours or a couple of minutes before, you have an option in the manifest file that you require configuration. And this is exactly how this displayed. So if you upload your connector requires configuration, you will see this one with configuration required, and you have to upload it. And how you upload it is basically click on it, and then you have to. Oh, normally it goes a bit to the. Normally you see it over here. Indeed, and then you can upload it. But I cannot upload it because one of the things you need for external content library is a stub folder, and you still need that particular stub folder there. And we cannot automate it because the stub folder can be a different folder on all kinds of machines. So if I go to this one, and then with stops, and maybe use this one as well. Well, this is 5. If I save this one, then go to my add-ons, say upload, and just modify this one. It is open. It says, hey, successfully deployed. And it's going to be in a pending situation. And the pending one is basically, it is not used yet. It's ready to be consumed. You have to use it somewhere to order to be loaded. And especially with ECL. So for ECL, how you can actually do it is, if you go to a publication, you can say you refresh. And also this polling mechanism is not like every second, it's like maybe sometimes half a minute. And then it will actually poll the add-on servers. Are there any new connectors for me? And then it will actually notify your application and will be ready in your application to be used. And now you see suddenly, hey, SDL Connect. Or Connect 2019. And this is the connector I just created from the template. It also has support for pagination as well. And you can also have thumbnails for this one. And this generating of the thumbnails uses the functionality that is provided by ECL for the implementation of the creating of the thumbnails. So we asked the connector framework, do you support creating of thumbnails? Yes, okay, use it. And that's how we did it in this particular template. I just want to briefly show it also in Visual Studio how this template looks like. If I go temp. So like I mentioned, we also need the manifest file. The manifest file is also generated for you in this particular template. The configuration, it is there ready to be uploaded and used. You notice that it only support page size 3, so you can actually customize it. There's also another reason why the customization is apart from the add-on itself. So if you want to develop an add-on, you develop only the add-on itself. You don't have to know which kind of remote system you're going to use. You can separate it. So you can actually write it once and then reuse it with multiple implementations of connections to remote systems. So you can also imagine maybe later on, we can, if you write an add-on, upload it to the STL App Store, people can download it, and then also specify their own implementation or configuration, and then it can be used. So you're not really have to think about, hey, I have to have the package, I have to unzip it, change the configuration, zip it again, and then upload it again. Now we separated those two for this particular reason. Also one thing, we also, if you're gonna use this particular template, we also did some analyzers installed as well. Or, yeah, some extra analyzers. I don't go into all the details, but every property has to be declared, for example, as a virtual. If you don't do it, then hopefully you get some highlighting there that said, hey, it actually, the property is not marked as virtual. If you can read it, I'm not sure, but. And then you also have the option then immediately to mark it as a virtual as well. So we have some analysis on your code that will hopefully also help you implementing the connector as well. And I think that also, yeah, it's for you easy to write and detect and prove that is according to some specifications we it must have. And then also, yeah, will speed up your implementation. This is basically how you define your configuration for the page size I was talking. This is basically the page size of the configuration. It's inherited from or implement the iConnector configuration, and this is the page size. One more thing about, I was talking about register applications or registering capabilities, I must say. And if you want to create a connector, you actually do it like this. You download servers. You can open also a list file server, so that supports actually getting a list of all the files for this particular connector. And then you implement the capabilities for it. For a particular type, you define your capabilities. But it is there. There's also a lot of documentation about those methods. And that will also help you probably implement this particular connector.